Rabotai, Pishut, Derav Shalita. I'm so happy to be with you today and to see the Rav Levi Shalita, the work he's doing, like his father, Buenos Aires, to spread the Torah all over. Today, it's the parasha of Vayhi Yaakov Be'eretz Mitzrayim 17 Shana. Yaakov Abinu, the best years that he had in his life, it was the 17 years that he lived in Egypt. Those were the best years. It was not years of holiday. It was not years because he found Yosef after more than 20 years that he did not see Yosef at Tzaddik. So don't think that was the best years that Yaakov Abinu had because he was with all his family. No. 17 Shana, it was full of Torah. He was happy with his family. He saw Baruch Hashem, his family, they did not change their clothes, they did not change their names, they did not change their language. That was his happiness. He saw 600,000 Jews in Eretz Goshen. That what made Yosef Yaakov Abinu happy. That was the best years that he had. There is a Midrash who said that Avraham Abinu, when he sent Eliezer to find Rivka for Yitzhak, he went with some camels and he had to shut their mouth so they would not eat from the ground of other people. You should know that to steal money from somebody, you're not allowed. And you're not allowed as well that your animals will go to land to somebody else and take from their grass. Not allowed. It's gezel. So the camels of Avraham Abinu, when they used to travel, they will shut their mouth so they will not eat from, they will not, because usually camels they eat. When they see grass they want, they go and eat. But the camels of Avraham Abinu, they shut their mouth so they will not eat. So I saw a nice question, a beautiful question, about Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair. Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, he was a big Tanna. He was the father-in-law of Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai. He was a big tzaddik. And the Gemara said that the animals, the horse, the donkey of Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, he will not eat from others' lands of other people. Even if you give him to eat, he will not eat. He only eats kosher. And he only eats what Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair will give him. So the question is, what? The animals of Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair are more clever than the animals of Avraham Avinu? That the animals of Avraham Avinu, you have to show their mouths that they will not eat. And the animals of Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, they can eat. They will not eat even if they don't shut their mouth. You know this famous story. One day there were some ganavim, some thief, they stole the donkey of Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair. And he will not eat because they were ganavim, because the food that they gave him, it was stolen from somebody else. So the hammer of Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, he will not eat. He nearly, so the ganavim, those who stole the donkey of Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, they were worried that he will die, so they let him go. They let him go. And when they arrived to the house of Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, he started to scream. So Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair said to his wife, the donkey must be very angry. go and prepare food for him. So from here you see that the donkey for Pippi has been Na'ir will not eat from other lands. Whatever you give him, he will only eat from what his master will give him. So how can you understand that the camels of Avraham Abinu, they were you have to close their mouth so they will not eat from others' land? You know, my friend, I would like to tell you this. There is a Orachem HaKadosh, fabulous Orachem HaKadosh, who said that when the Bnei Israel, they left Egypt and they arrived and Paro was running after them, so the Am Israel, they arrived to the sea, and there was a sea and there was no way to go. Not only they don't know how to swim, but all the children, all the belonging, how can they go into the sea? So Moshe Rabbeinu said, Hashem, Ribono Shel Olam, what can I do? Hashem said to Moshe, Moshe, carry on, go. And Moshe said, go where? So Hashem said to Moshe, you know what? Show your baston to the sea, and the sea will divide. So Moshe Rabbeinu took the stick and he showed it to the sea by it. And then, his hand, show your hand to the sea and the sea will divide. Moshe Rabbeinu, he showed his hand to the sea and the sea will not divide. The sea said to Moshe Rabbeinu, Moshe, I will not listen to you. You are nothing for, no, I will not divide for you. But Hashem told me to tell you. No, I don't care. So Moshe Rabbeinu said to Hashem, Bona Sha'olam, the sea will not divide. So Am Israel have a problem. So Hashem may appear. When he appeared, the sea, Ra'ah Hayam Vayanus. When the sea saw Hashem, so the sea went, divide himself. So Orachem HaKadosh, Alav HaShalom, he asked a beautiful question. He said, what? The Talmid, Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair, is stronger than Moshe Rabbeinu. One day, Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair, he wanted to cross the river, and he was in a hurry. So what he did? He took his belt, and he hit the river. He said to the river, you split, I have to pass. And the river said no. So Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair said to the river, if you don't listen to me, I'll dry you. There will be no more water coming here. So suddenly the sea, the river split. So Rahim HaKadosh asked a beautiful question. So how it's possible Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair, he divided the river, and Moshe Rabbeinu, that he was the prophet, the big tzaddik, the most powerful man of the world at that time, the most biggest prophet of all time, he could not, the sea was not afraid of him, he would not divide. And the Or HaChaim HaKadosh gave a beautiful answer. Or HaChaim HaKadosh said, there is a big difference between Moshe Rabbeinu and Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair. The generation, those two generations are different. The generation of Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair, they had the Torah. This, the Torah. All those tzaddikim that we had, all the miracles that they did the miracles with the zechut of the Torah. Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair was a big Tana with the zechut of the Torah. You know, my friend, with the zechut of the Torah, you know, Baal Shem Tov, Rabbi Chaim Pinto, Rabbi Yaakov Vehsera, all those tzaddikim that we had, and Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Rabbi Meir Ba'al Nes, all the miracles that he did. How did he do them? You think because Jews they do miracles? No, it was with the zechut of the Torah. When a tzaddik studied Torah, when he kept Torah mitzvot, when he connect himself all his life, when all his life is Torah, so HaKadosh Baruch Hu can change. The Torah said, "Kodesh Baruch Hu istakel be'alma be'oraito bar'alma." HaKadosh Baruch Hu created the world through the Torah. He looked the Torah and he created the world. And Hashem, he made a condition of the world that when there is a tzaddik who studied Torah, whatever the tzaddik will ask, the world has to accept. You know, there is a millions of stories. I was just to tell you one small story that with my grandfather, Alav Shalom, Rabbi Haim Pinto. One day, Rabbi Haim Pinto, Alav Shalom, he was walking in the street. He was walking in the street. That it was 3 weeks ago. Somebody told me that story, Rabbi Alush. And that time, Rabbi Haim Pinto was old, and he was blind. He could not see. And when he was walking, he knew all the people that they were around him, and they would even mention names. Hey, David. Hey, Moshe. And he was blind. He did not see. He could not see with his eyes, but he could see with his Ruach HaKodesh. That somebody told me this a few weeks ago. He said that his father told him how many times he wanted just to test Rabbi Haim Pinto. He walked behind him just to see if Rabbi Haim Pinto will notice that he is behind him. And then Rabbi Haim Pinto, he said, "Hey David, I know you are behind me. Hey David, hey, you want to test me? You want to see if I see you? Of course I see you." How he see him? He's blind. How can he see him? This is about the Ruach of the Torah, the Ruach HaKodesh. Besides that, maybe he don't see through his physical eyes, but he can see from Ruach HaKodesh. Those are the tzaddikim. Those are the tzaddikim. Moshe Rabbeinu at his generation, when Moshe Rabbeinu, when he appeared, when he came to the sea, and he told the sea, "Hashem, he told me to tell you to divide yourself." At that time, the Bnei Israel did not receive yet the Torah. So, the nature will not change for those who don't study Torah. So Hashem, he said to the sea, "I know you're right. You're right. You will not divide yourself. You will not split for Am Yisrael because they did not receive Torah. But they are going now to receive the Torah." And that was a message for generation. That the world, that the tzaddikim have the power to change anything you want when there is the Kuwah of the Torah. In Morocco, and in Marrakesh, there was no rain. And they went to Rabbi Elazar, I think, Rabbi Elazar Sebag, who was a big tzaddik, and they asked him, "If there is no rain now, next year there will be no matzah. We will not eat matzah. So we need Geshem, we need the rain." So Rabbi Elazar Sebag, Alav Shalom, he said, "Well, you know, tomorrow we will meet in the cemetery, we pray in the cemetery." And they all went to the cemetery, and Rabbi Elazar, Alav Shalom, Sebag, he left his hand toward the Shamayim. He said, "Ribbono Shel Olam, you give us the Torah, and you said in the Torah that we should eat on Pesach the matzot. We should not eat the chametz. We want to listen to you, but give us the rain, give us the gshamim, give us the rain. If you don't give us the rain, if there is no raining, there will be no matzah next year. If there is no matzah next year, maybe we have to eat bread. So now you have to choose. What do you want, Hashem, from us? You want that we respect Torah and mitzvot? So give us the gshamim, give us the rain." And then Rabbi Elazar Sebag, he said to everybody, "Hurry up home because it's going to rain." And after a few minutes, the rain will not stop. You know, there is millions of stories like that. When that was the message of Hashem to Am Israel. Now that there is no Torah, you see, no, you cannot do miracles. Nothing. The nature will not change for you. But the nature will change for you when you study Torah. And that, this is Rabotai, the message. That was the message of Hashem to Am Israel. And I think that message was spectacular, because that message was directly for the Bnei Israel to think, ay, 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 if there is Torah, the word becomes is our the word. We listen to whatever we ask. If there is Torah, whatever we want, from anything we want, it will happen. But without Torah, nothing can happen. Between you and me, you know, where Am Israel, they were in Eretz Israel, and they were keeping Torah mitzvot. You know, there was we had few kings, few melachim, that they were very, very different. There was a king that he said to Hashem, Ribono Shel Olam, I will go fight the enemies, but Hashem, I will not go after them. They will come to me and they will fail in front of me. There was another tzaddik. He said, Hashem, I will go to fight the enemies, but I will not fight them. Just when I look at them, they will die. And there was another one, Hizkiah Melech, another kind of king. He said, Ribono Shel Olam, I want to rest, I want to sleep, I want to be in bed, and when the enemies come, they will die. I will not fight them at all. How can you imagine? How can you imagine this? This is when Am Yisrael study Torah and keep Torah and mitzvot. When Am Yisrael study Torah and keep Torah and mitzvot, well, their work is done by the Shamayim. Everything is done by the Shamayim. Now we understand the message that Hashem he wanted to show to the Bnei Israel, because I was Bemet, I was thinking all the time, why Akash Baruch Hu put the Bnei Israel in that situation, that Hashem told them go in front of the sea, and they arrived to the sea, and the sea was there. I mean, I was thinking that when the Bnei Israel will arrive to the sea will split. No, Hashem said to Moshe, show your hand. And then when Moshe showed his hand, the sea will not split. So that was a big problem. And what it is, the answer, the message of this, the message is, hey, Am Yisrael, hey, Jews, you're going to go now to receive the Torah. When you receive the Torah, you respect Torah and mitzvot, everything will change for you. There is a lot of tzaddikim, Bemet. I know, in Morocco, there was a tzaddik, his name is Rabbi Pinchas Abisror. And this Rabbi Pinchas Abisror, he was very poor man, but no one know about him. No one. I remember him. I know him very, very well. But I remember him. I was 8 years old. And we thought he was a normal man. We didn't think he was a tzaddik. But until one Friday, that he went to buy fish and had no money. And this tzaddik was very, very a big tzaddik. He was very, very poor, and always on Friday he used to walk with bags in his hand, empty bags. He wanted just to show people, that he's buying, you know, food for Shabbat, and he had nothing for Shabbat. He was a big anav. He didn't want that people will think, why this man is so poor? Why is this? Man, he acts, he's a rabbi, he acts like a big tzaddik. Why is so? He wanted just to show people that he's not poor. He wanted to show people that he go to the shopping and he put in his bag the papers just to make so that people will not think bad thing about Hashem. And that Friday, he was there an Arab who was selling his fish. And the Rabbi Hassab Israel went, he said, he saw an Arab who was cutting the fish, preparing the fish for a good Jewish customer to come to buy it. And Rabbi Hassab Israel, alayhi shalom, he said, I cannot afford to buy the whole fish, but if you can sell me just the head of the fish, because anyway, no one will eat the head of the fish. I have a few coins if you want. And the Arab looked at him. He said, so you want the head of the fish? Huh? I will give you the head of the fish. And he cut, it was an anti-Jew, this Arab. He cut the head of the fish, and he threw it on Rabbi Pinchas Abisror. And he told him, hey, Jew, This is for your Shabbat. Rabbi Hasabi saw, look at him, and he told him, I don't care that you threw the head of the fish on me, but you joke about Shabbat, I forgive you what you did to me, but I don't think that Hashem will forgive you that you curse Shabbat. And as soon he turned, that Arab dropped dead. And that all Morocco, all Essaouira heard that story. And from that day, the Arabs and the Jews, they started respecting this rabbi that they did not know before that he was a tzaddik. Those are the tzaddikim. Tzaddikim, you know, you are tzaddikim as well, huh? What do you think? You are tzaddikim as well. Ve'amech konam tzaddikim. Baruch Hashem. It's Sunday. You came to listen to Shiur. You come on Shabbat. You eat kosher. You do, Baruch Hashem, sacrifice. You are tzaddikim. You think today it's easy to be a tzaddik today? You think today it's easy to do Torah mitzvot? It's not easy today. Even for me, it's not easy. Don't think it's easy for me too. I have the same. Your etzara is my etzara too. Is that maybe my etzara is bigger than yours? Because I need to fight him more than you. What do you think? You think it's easy? You think the etzara it's only for you, not for rabbis? No, Behemet, you don't know how much I fight him. I fight him day and night. Do you think I don't want to look at television? Do you think I don't want to go to the beach? Do you think I don't want to do all the things that everybody does? I want as well. But I know that I can't. I know that Hashem is watching me. I know that I will not do it. I know that there is better than this. There is better pleasure. There is a better olam. I know that with conviction, not only because he told me. I know. When I study Torah, I get the pleasure, the same pleasure that you can get for anything in the world. When you study Torah, the pleasure you get in the Torah Behemet, there is no other pleasure than the pleasure of keeping Torah mitzvot. I would like to tell you something that I do and I like most. Shabbat. Shabbat for me is something very, very important. Besides the Shabbat himself, but the preparation of Shabbat. To prepare Shabbat. Usually a lot of people, they come home a few minutes for Shabbat, they have a wash, they come to the synagogue. And the wife, she's doing other work. But the real Shabbat is, when you test the Shabbat, you go home a little bit early, and you help your wife. When you will test Shabbat, the test of Shabbat will be different. Not the same test that you've been testing up to now. Shabbat is not something easy. Shabbat is the day that Hashem blessed. He said, the day of Hashem. All week is blessed b'schut Shabbat Kodesh. And Shabbat, according to Ben Ishaya Kadosh, why Hashem, he give us Shabbat? Because Hashem, he know that all week we are busy. We have to work. We have no time. So Shabbat, Baruch Hashem, Shabbat, we have all time to study Torah. We don't work. The Hafetz Chaim said something incredible. The Hafetz Chaim said, people should know that the same way that they have to work to bring Parnasa to their house, they should know that half in the evening they must go and study Torah for half an hour. They must know that half an hour that they study Torah once a day, it's more important than all day work. That half an hour is the bracha for all the day. So now you understand the message of Hashem. The message of Hashem was spectacular. The message of Hashem is, without Torah, there is nothing. There is no bracha. The world cannot change. Karov Hashem lechol korav lechol ashikaru beemet. Hashem is near, close to those who call Hashem. But Be'emet, emet it's Torah. When there is Torah with you, when you study Torah, you keep Torah mitzvot, so Hashem will answer you right away, like he did to the tzaddikim. So because the Jews did not receive the Torah, so the Yam Suf will not listen. But Bipin has been Yair. Why when he said to the river to divide, otherwise he will dry her up? Because he has the koach of the Torah. He has the power of the Torah. With the zichut of the Torah that he had, the river was afraid of him. Now, according to all what I'm telling you, you understand. The camels of Abraham, Abinu, Alav Shalom, at that time they did not receive the Torah yet. Abraham, he respected the Torah, but the Torah officially was not given. So the word, the Torah did not come to the world. So Abraham Abinu Alav Shalom, he didn't want to take any chance. He didn't want to take any risk. So he had to shoot the mouth of the camel so they will not eat the grass of other lands. Because from here, Rabotai Bemet, forgive me to tell you this. From here I understand that the animals, they know when the Torah was given, and they know when the Torah was not given yet. It's incredible. When the Torah was given, not only the people knew that the Torah was given, even the animals, they knew, even the trees, they knew that the Torah now, it's here, it's in the world. But up till that Hashem did not give the Torah to Am Yisrael, Har Sinai, no one knew that the Torah was given. So only some tzaddikim like Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov, that he could do miracles. But the animals, for them, they felt that the Torah is not yet was given. So that's what Abraham Abinu Alav Shalom, he had to shoot the mouth of the camels. But at the time, the generation of Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, at that time, yes, the Torah was given. Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair was studying Torah. In the Beit HaMidrash. So he's a donkey, he's Hamorim, the animals that belong to him, they know that they are not allowed. How did they know? They are animals. Yes, they are animals, but they know there is Torah. And because they belong to Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, so they will not eat something that is not kosher. It's incredible. In Morocco, in Issawira, there was a dog. I remember that dog. And that dog, they used to call him the Brit Mila dog. Ah, no? What's this? They used to call him the Brit Mila dog. Any time that there was a Brit Mila, that dog was there. Well, I mean, a dog, he don't talk. I mean, he don't receive an invitation card. He's not invited to a Brit Mila. But all the time, when there is a Brit Mila, we see that dog there. Sunday, sometimes he had to run away to free houses because there is free Brit Mila. And they used to call him the Brit Mila dog. And then the rabbis, I remember, even my father said, he said that dog, he must have a gilgul of something, a gilgul. Maybe he has a neshama that he had to repair something that he did not do before. And when he died one Shabbat during a Brit Mila ceremony. He died. Yeah, he died there. That means that he came to his tikkun. His tikkun, that means that his neshama was repaired. My friend Rabotai, I want just to tell you this, and I finished. I was in Buenos Aires a few months ago. No, a few weeks ago. Maybe 3 weeks ago. And I was in the car with one of my friends. I was invited to his house, Marcus Wade. And I saw an empty street. There was no cars, nothing, empty. So I said, Marco, usually in this area, it's full. So he said, well, but they are all in their house because there is a big match of football. Rivers against... against?
Boca Juniors. Boca
Junior. I guess Boca Junior, I don't know. I said, so what? So what? He said, well, it's a big game. So he said, Rabbi David, can you give a bracha that reverse we win? So I told him, what difference would it make to you if they win or they lose? He said, well, because you me, I am in your house, so rest assured to be, so that you'll be happy all night. So rest assured, I hear a song that they win, but I don't understand if they win, what you will win? Nothing. They will get money, you get nothing. So they will get glories, honors, and you get nothing. So said, we were waiting. It was there of some rabbis in the house, and suddenly we heard God, you know, we heard a big voice. The house was shaking. I said, and the screams came from every house. Every house. It reminds me of Egypt. Makat Bechorot. There was no house that it was not. There was no house that it was not. People. They were not screaming there. They were screaming everywhere. I was scared. And Rabbi Antebi said, Rabbi David, I think Rivers score a goal. Said there. So now, after the meal, we had to go somewhere else for a Sheva Brachot. And there was a man who came a little bit late. I said, why you came late? He said, well, he was with his son. He said, well, said, tell me what. So somebody said, he went to see the match. So you went to see the match. How was the match? How was the game? So he said the game was spectacular, it was good. And he said, so I told him, tell me exactly what happened. And he said, Rabbi David, when the game finished, I took my son and I gave him a big hug. We were crying and crying and crying. You were crying for a game. You won nothing. You cry. Yes, it's happiness. Happiness. That shook me. You know why it shook me? I told him, tell me, how old are you? Say, I am 51. Have you screamed one day in your life with happiness for a mitzvah that it came to your hand? Have you said, God, Baruch Hashem! The same way you did for you cry, you talk, you, did you take the etrog and the lula? Ah, kapara, ah, etrog. All year I didn't kiss you, all year I didn't see you since last year. Have you done this before? No. For a game, you took your hand, you took your son with a big hug, you kiss him, and crying for joy, with joy. You've done this for a mitzvah. That picture, that's what Hashem is going to show you after 120 years. He will show you all your life. You'll be screaming, God, 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 God. And never you've been happy doing a mitzvah. After 120 years, what do you take with you? The pictures of rivers? You take with you any disc in the city of if there is there up there, there is river up there. There is nothing there. There you will see the emet. There you will be very embarrassed. They will embarrass you. When you see you will see the emet, you will see that the Torah is the emet, and you will see how much you waste your time. You loved something that the pleasure of that thing will not last forever. This is Rabotai, the mistake. And this is Olam Hazeh. And this is the Yetzer Hara. He's very strong. The Yetzer Hara is very clever. The Yetzer Hara has all his time for you. All his time. Just to make you mixed up. That you will not follow the right derech. And Baruch Hashem, this parasha of this week, Ele Shemot Bnei Israel. This is the names of the Jews that they came to Egypt. Those were the same Jews that they came with Yaakov. Now Yaakov passed away. And now he's a new generation. Ele, they remain the same. They did not change. This is Rabotai, the lesson. We are here in Miami. We come from Morocco. We come from France. We come from Eretz Israel. We come from all over the world. But we should not change. Ele Shemot Bnei Israel. If you want not to be changed, only if you stick to the Torah Kedusha. Once upon a time, there was no Torah. So people change. One day they are Obed Avodah Zarah, one day they think the sun is God, one day it's the moon, one day it's the tree, one day it's this, one. But now that we have the Torah, now, Baruch Hashem, we know what it is, the emet, what it is, the true. So Be'ezat Hashem Rabotai, take Musar, take moral from the animals of Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair. Yes, sir. Take Musa from those animals that they realize, they feel, they smell Torah in the house of Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair. They are animals. They have no, Hashem did not give them the Torah. They are not obligated to respect Torah and mitzvot. They are animals. They can eat, they can do whatever they want. They are animals. But the Ashpah, the influence of Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair, the influence, the Torah that Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair studied, that Hashpah of Torah of Rabbi Pinchas Ben Yair, his animals, they felt it, they smell it, and they respect it, and they live with it, so they will not eat something that is not kosher. They will not eat something that was not ma'aser. They will not eat something that was stolen. Those are the why? Because of the Torah. Once, when the Rabota, you respect Torah and mitzvot, all what there is around you, they will respect it. My friend, I would like just to wish you bracha, v'atzlacha, b'riut. I would like to give a bracha to the Rabbi Ablevi for the work he's doing, for the school, for the Zikor Abim, and Yeratzon, Shekadosh Baruch Hu, we give him bracha v'atzlacha. May Hashem give you, to all of you, refuah shelema, panasa tova, b'riut v'et Hashem. And don't forget one thing. Be koveya itim la Torah. You must think, give few sometimes from your time for Hashem. HaKadosh Baruch Hu give you all his time. When you sleep, he take care of you. He wake you up in the morning. When you drive, he take care of you when you drive. He help you to get married. He help you to have children. So it give all his time for you. So you as well give your time. Not all the time, at least what you can. And I promise you, by giving some of your time to Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will be proud of you. HaKadosh Baruch Hu will be very, very happy. Hashem, we don't want to feel that we take advantage of him. Hashem want to feel that he give and he get. He don't want to feel that only he give, he get nothing. Like somebody told me last week, and you go to synagogue, you know what was his answer? I have no time. And I told him, you have no time. And Hashem has time for you. So maybe Hashem one day, he will have no time for you in the morning. No, Rabbi David, don't tell me this. He said, but you must, the same way that you want that Hashem will give you all his time, Jewish way, you must find some time for Hashem. Come to Tshila, Shi'ur. After 120 years, you cannot say to Hashem, I have no time, I had no synagogue, I had no rabbi, because Baruch Hashem, you have everything here. You have a synagogue, you have a rabbi, you have a Bnei Torah, Baruch Hashem, you have everything. So Rabotai, Yei Ratzon Shekosh Baruch Hu Yiten Lachem, Berakha Vehatzlacha Vebriut.
حيم بنتو وقت لنا زي خون.